Good morning, class 7. Today we will start with 7th chapter of your history, tribes, nomads and settled communities. So you can understand the three terms, tribes, that is people who are living in the uncivilized group. Mostly they are living in the forest areas. Then you talk about nomads who do not have their own houses, and settled communities, people who are living in the cities or in the like urban areas or in the villages, right? So they are, we will be discussing all these three communities. You saw in chapter 2, 3 and 4 how kingdoms rose and fell. Even as this was happening, new arts, crafts and production activities flourished in towns and villages. Over the centuries, important political, social and economic developments had taken place. But social change was not the same everywhere, because different kinds of societies evolved differently. It is important to understand how and why this happened. So you must have studied this in chapter 2, 3. If you can recall, we have studied it in chapter 2, 3 and 4, that how the kingdoms, they rose, they came to power, then how they collapsed. And even when these things were happening, the crafts, the art, how it was flourishing in different kingdoms over the centuries, important political, social and economic developments had taken place. But social change was not the same everywhere, because different kinds of societies evolved differently. It is important to understand how and why this happened. In large parts of the subcontinent, society was already divided according to the rules of Varna. These rules, as prescribed by the Brahmins, were accepted by the rulers of large kingdoms. The difference between the high and low and between the rich and poor increased. Under the Delhi Sultans and the Mughals, this hierarchy between social classes grew further. So, in large parts of the subcontinent, you can say that the society, it was like already divided. Initially also it was divided on the basis of the Varna system. Then these rules, as prescribed by the Brahmins, were accepted by the rulers that time. Whatever the Brahmins have prescribed, it was accepted by the rulers. The difference between the high and the low, rich and the poor, that increased. Under Delhi Sultans and the Mughals, the hierarchy between social class, that increased even further. Beyond big cities, tribal societies, there were, however, other kinds of societies as well. Many societies in the subcontinent did not follow the social rules and rituals prescribed by the Brahmins, nor were they divided into numerous unequal classes. Such societies are often called tribes. So, other kinds of societies. Many societies in the subcontinent, they do not follow like certain rules and rituals prescribed. Like they didn't follow what the rules and rituals were set by the Brahmins. So they were divided into unequal classes and they were often called as tribes. Members of each tribe were united by kinship bonds. Many tribes obtained their livelihood from agriculture. Others were hunter-gatherers or herders. Most often they combined these activities to make full use of the natural resources of the area in which they lived. Some tribes were nomadic and moved from one place to another. A tribal group controlled land and pastures jointly and divided these amongst households according to their own rules. So there were different tribes, and most of them, they didn't follow the rules or rituals set up by the Brahmins. They had their own rules and regulations. They were united with each other. I mean, you know, they had a bonding with each other. and they obtained like they had their livelihood through like they followed agriculture, and like many of them were hunter gatherers or herders, and they combined these activities to make full use of the natural resources. Some tribes were nomadic, that means they lived at one place, utilized the resources available there, and once they had resources have been exhausted, they moved to another place and moved from one place to another. A tribal group controlled land and pastures jointly and divided these amongst household according to its own rule. Many large tribes thrived in different parts of the subcontinent. They usually lived in forest, hills, deserts and places difficult to reach. Sometimes they clashed with the more powerful caste-based societies. In various ways, the tribes retained their freedom and preserved their separate culture. So there were many tribes who were like, many people were there, so it was a large tribe. They thrived in different parts, lived in different parts of the continent. They usually lived in forest, hills, deserts and places difficult to reach. Sometimes they clashed with the more powerful caste-based societies. In various ways, the tribes retained their freedom and preserved their separate culture. But the caste-based and tribal societies also depended on each other for their diverse needs. This relationship of conflict and dependence gradually caused both societies to change. Okay, so obviously these societies, tribal societies, and like whether they were tribal ones or the caste based, they were dependent on each other. So their although they had conflicts, but then gradually their relationship changed, because obviously they both were dependent on each other. Who were tribal people? Contemporary historians and travelers give very scanty information about tribes. A few exceptions apart, tribal people did not keep written records, but they preserved rich customs and oral traditions. These were passed down to each new generation. Present-day historians have started using such oral traditions to write tribal histories. So contemporary means historians, those who were present in that era, in that time, and the travelers, they give very less information, scanty means very less information about these tribes. A few exceptional apart tribal people did not keep written records, but they preserved rich custom and oral tradition. These were passed down to each generation. Present-day historians have started using such oral traditions to write tribal histories. Tribal people were found in almost every region of the subcontinent. The area and influence of a tribe varied at different point of time. Some powerful tribes controlled large territories. In Punjab, the Khokhar tribe was very influential during the 13th and 14th century. Later, the Gakhar became more important. Their chief, Kamal Khan Gakhar, was made a noble mansabdar, that is, by Emperor Akbar. In Multan and Sindh, the Langa and Arghun dominated extensive region before they were subdued by the Mughals. The Balochis were another large and powerful tribe in the northwest. They were divided into many smaller clans under different chiefs. In the western Himalaya lived the Shepherd tribe of Gadis. The distant northeastern part of subcontinent was entirely dominated by tribes, the Nagas, Ahoms, and many others. In many areas of present-day Bihar and Jharkhand, Chero chiefdoms had emerged by the 12th century. Raja Man Singh, Akbar's famous general, attacked and defeated the Charon Charos in 1591. So now, who were the tribal people? First of all, we do not get much of the information because the contemporary historian and the travelers, they have not written much about them. They have very written very scanty information we get from their records. And then tribal people were found in almost every region of the subcontinent. Some powerful tribes controlled large continents. In Punjab, the Kokhar tribe was very influential during the 13th century, 13th and 14th century. Now later, the Gakhars became more important. Their chief Kamal Khan Gakhar was made noble during the reign of Emperor Akbar. Then Balochis were among another large and powerful tribe in northwest. They were divided into many smaller clans under different chiefs. In the western Himalaya lived the Shepherd. In the western Himalaya lived the Shepherd tribe of Gadis. The distant northeastern part of the subcontinent was entirely dominated by the tribes, the Nagas, the Ahoms, and many others. In many areas of present-day Bihar and Jharkhand, Chero chiefdoms had emerged by the 12th century. So different, now you can come to know different the name of the different tribes from here. That in present-day Bihar and Jharkhand, the Chero chiefdoms, this tribe was defeated by Raja Man Singh. He was a famous general in the reign of Akbar. In 1591, a large amount of booty was taken from them, but they were not entirely subdued. Under Aurangzeb, Mughal forces captured many Chero fortresses and subjugated the tribe. The Mundas and Santals were among the other important tribes that lived in this region and also in Orissa and Bengal. So the Mundas and the Santals are the other tribes. The Maharashtra highlands and Karnataka were home to Kolis, Bharats, and numerous other. Kolis also lived in many areas of Gujarat. Further south were large tribal population of Koragas, Betars, Marwars, and many others. The large tribe of Bhils was spread across western and central India. By the late 16th century, many of them had become settled agriculturists and some even zamindars. Many Bhil clan nevertheless remained hunter-gatherers. The Gonds were found in great numbers across the present-day states of Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Andhra Pradesh. So, if you in Maharashtra, you can know that in the Maharashtra highlands and our Karnataka, the tribe which lived was Kolis, Bharats. Kolis lived in many parts of Gujarat as well. Then there were large tribes of Bhils who spread across the western and central India. So with this, we end the chapter here for today. We'll continue it in the next class. Do read the chapter. Take care of yourselves. Be safe at home. Thank you, class.